Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Tessa Evans-Campbell, the school's Associate Dean for Academic Affairs. I'm delighted to see you here today. Thank you for coming. In this season of gathering remotely, we're excited to host this very special online lecture series called The Leading Lights. It features distinguished scholars and teachers at the School of Social Work who are leading the way to systemic social change. The special series, created by Eddie O'Hara, the Balmer Endowed Dean in Social Work, features one-hour lectures by our top scholars and teachers at the UW School of Social Work who have made foundational contributions to the field. These online sessions were designed as a special offering to MSW students in the entering class of 2020, with other students, alumni, and friends invited to attend. The series offers students and others a way to introduce esteemed faculty and their work during a time of remote instruction. We know that you all will find these presentations illuminating, thought-provoking, and inspiring. The series will run through late 2021 with a summer break, and we'll publicize them through our usual channels. A 30-minute student-only Q&A with the speaker will follow each lecture. Today, I am thrilled we have a talk by our beloved colleague, Karina Walters. Karina, we are so excited to hear from you.
Yeah, okay, thank you for having me. Do you want me to go ahead and get started, Tessa?
Oh, sorry, I think Mike is going to introduce you.
Okay, thank you.
Good evening, everyone. It's good to see you all virtually. My name is Mike Spencer, and I'm a professor here at the University of Washington School of Social Work. And I'm very proud to be able to introduce Dr. Karina Walters for a number of reasons, not only because she is one of the most incredible scholars that I've ever met, but she's also one of my dear colleagues, someone who I respect, someone who has been pretty much by me the whole step of the way throughout my whole career. We first met when we were doctoral students a while ago. So happy that we're reunited here at UW. And you know, I won't say too much about the many accomplishments of Dr. Walters because there are many, but I will just suffice to say that she is a professor and the Catherine Chambers Hall University Scholar. She is one of the co-directors of the Indigenous Wellness Research Institute. She is, in addition to being the co-director, the principal investigator of many, many NIH grants, as well as co-investigator of even more, and has published some of the leading work in the area of Native American and American Indian scholarship around health, mental health, substance abuse, historical trauma, resilience, as well as theorizing the indigenous health model as well. So, so much that she's done over her career, and she has been recently moving in new directions as well, particularly with regards to a lot of her land-based work, which is something that I admire and something that I'm also trying to implement in my own work as well. So, you know, so that we can have as much time as possible for her, let me stop speaking and let me introduce you all to Dr. Karina Walters. Thank you so much.
Yeah, okay, thank you both Dr. Evans-Campbell and Dr. Spencer. And thank you to Dean O'Hara and the Leading Light Lecture Series here at the School of Social Work. I'm going to introduce myself. Halitosa Chipa at Karina Walters, Micha Chatasi Yahoke, Micha Yokoke Okla, Duwamish, Micha Yokoke Okla, Snohomish. Greetings, everybody. My name is Karina Walters. I'm an enrolled member of the Choctaw Nation of Oklahoma, and I'm speaking to you from the lands of actually the historical lands where the Snohomish used to summer, but also I'm recognizing the ancestral territories in which the school sits, which is with the Duwamish and Coast Salish people of the region who's had many longhouses on the property that is now known as University of Washington. And so today I'm going to talk a little bit about the title of my talk is Living the Dreams of Our Ancestors and Transcending Historical Trauma. And so I'd like to talk a little bit about starting with the theme of water. And I'm going to share a little bit through the different elements of the work that I've done in the area of historical trauma, but some of the more exciting work that I'm doing now in partnership with Choctaw Nation of Oklahoma and other Choctaw researchers to address historical trauma and land-based healing. So I'll share a little bit of that work that we're doing right now. But first, let's talk a little bit about water. You see the picture of water behind me. That is the waters right off of in southeastern Oklahoma, where our tribe is currently, Choctaw Nation of Oklahoma, or I descend from the people that survived the Trail of Tears. And this is now our territory in southeastern Oklahoma. But our university stands near beautiful water, an area known to local tribes is truly sacred and beloved. And historically, waters are one of the most important native centers for life and well-being, including spiritual and physical sustenance, as well as trade. So today, we stand near this beloved water and have the opportunity to share, trade, and exchange, and provide sustenance to one another through some teachings. So I want us to think of that water today as we talk about historical trauma. Indigenous teachings teach us that water is literally our first medicine. The majority of our world is made up of it, our bodies as well. We are literally birthed from our mother's waters, and that's why we talk about water is life. So think about this a little bit today when you take that sip of water. The water we drink today, where does it go? It simply rises up to the heavens from the lips of our ancestors to come back to us. That water is the same. So when we take a sip of that water today, know that you're touching the same water that the lips of your ancestors touched. So our bodies are directly connected in that way to the ancestors since time immemorial and belongs to future generations as well. Just as we have these deep ancestral connections with water in place, our health too has deep connections to previous generations' wellness, oppression, and life circumstances. So how we address our health and health inequities now will determine the wellness for our children's grandchildren and for generations to come. Our Indigenous imperative for building innovative services to address health inequities must recognize the complex connections from structural inequities to epigenetic memories. Our bodies, our minds, and our spirits are inextricably linked across space, time, and place. Health inequities are driven by the cumulative impact of structural racism and settler colonialism that we experience over our lifetime, and indeed over our ancestors' lifetimes. And these types of structural inequities and racism can outweigh even the benefits of higher social class status. So our health inequities are created and reinforced by structural inequities that have persisted for generations. These social, historical, and cultural determinants are where health inequities take root and grow. The systemic factors making a difference in our health outcomes then are living under conditions of material deprivation as children and adults. It's the larger colonial-based structural factors in which everyday interactions are embedded. It is the historical trauma exposure, as well as the chronic stress and violence and traumatic events associated with such conditions. And at times, the adoption of health risk behaviors as means of surviving these systems and circumstances. But to achieve wellness, though, is to focus not actually on the deprivation and struggle, not on the historical trauma out of context in relation to our resiliency and strength, which is very strong. It's not about adopting a victim mindset or the medicalization of our understandable health struggles in the face of oppression and settler colonialism. Rather, it's actually a story about our collective strength, our collective resilience, our collective survivance. So when I talk about historical trauma today, what I'm really talking about is a story of power, love, and vision. And when I talk about power, this is what I mean. It's what a powerful place to be in this moment. In this moment, I am my grandmother's granddaughter. In this moment, I am my granddaughter's ancestor. In this moment, I'm all of these things. And if in this moment I care for my health and I heal not only myself, but the future generations. I heal not only myself and my family, I Heal the Ancestors' Pain that did not get the opportunity to heal, that still continues to be a part of my body. In this moment, I'm all of those things. In this moment, I have the power to transform. So that's a powerful place to be. It's not a victim mindset at all. And the other part I want us to think about with historical trauma, as I talk about this a little bit today, is love. So when you hear historical trauma, I want you to think about love. It's a story of love. It's the vision our ancestors carried for us as they struggled beyond the confines of the trauma that they were experienced, as they powered through the aftermath of historically traumatic events, as they resisted in different kinds of ways to preserve their life force and to preserve the stories and teachings for future generations. Through that all, they had love for us. And they held a vision for us to live healthily and to carry on. And they endured for the love of us. My ancestors actually did this as we were forced to leave our homelands, which were in Mississippi. And even thousands of years ago before that, we also were forced to remove from our ancient homelands and arrive to what is known as Nanawaya, Mississippi. And along that walk, we refused to leave our ancestors behind. We actually literally carried the bones of our ancestors on that very long journey. That is how much they loved their ancestors. That is how much they loved us. That is how much we love our future generations as well. So it's also a story of vision. Just as they held that vision for us, we are the keepers of the vision for the next generations. In sometimes we say the next seven generations in all that we do. So we must carry forward. So these are the stories I want you to keep in mind when I talk about historical trauma, the power, the love, and the vision. We are not and should not be defined by our collective struggles and our trauma, but rather by our ancestral teachings. Our ancestors is who define us, the life ways, instructions for our healthful living, those original instructions for protocols for health and well-being and how to take care of one another and the environment and for future generations. So that is the vision of the love and the ancestors held for us, and that we too in turn hold for future generations. And that is what I'd like us to think about as I share about historical trauma today. I just want to acknowledge the ancestors who I'm a part of and sharing. I just as I acknowledge the ancestors of the land in which the school is and where my home sits. This is my people originally. We descend, and I descend specifically from my family background from the Monville, Alabama, Mississippian people, who later we know as Choctaw. And that's some of our ancient homelands. We're part of a Mississippian peoples who are mound builders all over the southeast through the northeast and into the Great Lakes. And this is our traditional land at Nanawaya and my ancestors who I acknowledge today who are with me as I share the story of Yapali, our health promotion leadership model for Choctaw women. I am going to be sharing a little bit about the different elements I'm going to share through the themes. The first was water, which I set the context for us understanding historical trauma, but I'll also be talking about the role of land, air, wind, and fire to think about how we think about transcending historical trauma. And I've talked about this, so I'm moving forward. The work that we're doing is guided by the Indigenous Stress Coping Model that we developed a number of years ago. So I'll be talking about framing historical trauma in terms of these major events, these traumatic events that have an impact on our wellness and our well-being. But I also won't have time to talk about, but I want to acknowledge the everyday chronic discriminatory events or microaggression distress that we also endure as Indigenous people. But most importantly, I want to acknowledge that not just because we're exposed to high rates of these kinds of stressful encounters in traumatic environments, doesn't mean we all do poorly. In fact, most of us do incredibly well despite such conditions. And that is because we have cultural protective factors that buffer the impact of those kinds of experiences on our well-being. Family, culture, language, all of these things provide a buffer from these traumatic events to impacting our health and well-being. And when I talk about our health and well-being, I really mean our overall health and well-being, including our land-based health, environmental health, our mental health, our spiritual health, our physical health. The whole thing. This is what it looks like in terms a conceptual model from a research point of view. One of the guiding questions through all of our work is how do traumatic stressors and events become embodied in our physical and mental health, as well as in our risk behaviors. From a native worldview, we have original instructions and stories that help us understand this phenomenon. So I'm going to be talking a little bit about that. But social and historical inequities can literally become embodied or taken up in our bodies. Some of the research is starting to demonstrate that in terms of some of the epigenetic research that is emerging, primarily from animal studies and now looking at some human studies as well. But bodies tell histories and stories, just as bones illuminate the important information about the everyday lives of our ancestors, whether or not those stories are actually conscious in our minds. Now, some of the critics contend that historical trauma effects are negligible once lifetime rates of abuse are accounted for. But there's amassing evidence at the cellular level that powerful, stressful environmental conditions can leave an imprint on the epigenome, the cellular material, that can be carried into future generations with devastating consequences. Examples of that neurobiological toll of stress on descendant generations' health can be seen in some of the research done on maternal psychological and nutritional stress. If a woman is very stressed during pregnancy, that impact can actually be seen in the adult offspring of her children being at more risk if they were overfed at certain developmental points in their life for obesity and diabetes. So that's an example of some of the intergenerational transmission of that kind of stress and risk. So studying the embodiment of historical trauma and its consequences actually allows us to determine the forces driving intergenerational patterns of health and disease, and then what we can do to make a difference as social workers and practitioners in addressing that. Embodiment, basically it reminds us that we cannot exclude social, historical, or cumulative experiences and impact on our wellness. Okay. Also, I want to acknowledge that just as we have historically traumatic experiences, we also have historically resilient experiences and deep love that also is transmitted across generations. And some of that work is important to be balancing the picture from the negative impacts of historical trauma and stress. Okay, moving on to is about historical trauma and thinking about land. And what I'm going to introduce a little bit is the role of settler colonialism as it has impacted historical trauma and understanding how these two things connect, because we can't talk about historical trauma without talking about settler colonialism. And what that means is it involves different viewpoints and different ways of seeing and understanding the world that is embedded in our structures and our systems today. A good example is an indigenous point of view. We have a lot of different sayings in different tribal cultures, but the gist of that saying is, I am the land is me, which is very different than a settler colonial viewpoint, which would be, I own the land is mine. So I wanted to kind of highlight how we have some very different viewpoints that that are embedded in structural realities in which our health is also embedded. So let's talk about settler colonialism. Settler colonialism is a distinct type of colonialism that functions through the replacement of indigenous populations with a settler society that invades and over time develops a distinctive identity and sovereignty over place. And it requires to some degree the erasure of the indigenous people of that place, and then also creating a story about the relationship to place that continues the erasure of the indigenous populations. And that's why I don't have time today, but you know, we almost have to start revisiting American Indian history for you to understand that even the stories that you're told about US history is quite often through this particular framework of maintaining a story that erases indigenous people from the history here. Settler colonialism drives to normalize continuous settler occupation, exploits lands and resources to which Native people have had genealogical relationships for time immemorial. Rowe and Tuck even say that the specific formation of colonialism in which people came to land inhabited by indigenous people, and they declare that land is a new home. So it's about the pursuit of land. It's not just about the pursuit of labor or resources. settler colonialism is also a persistent societal structure. It's not just a historical event, and it's also not just a story for the actual nation state. So in other words, it is a structure. Settler colonialism is throughout the structures of our current system. Settler colonialism has meant genocide of indigenous peoples, the reconfiguring of indigenous land into settler property, and in the US and other nations that have had slave states at different points in history, it has also meant the theft of people from their homelands, from Africa in particular, to become property of settlers to labor on unceded territory and land. So there are structures and policies that support this, this continuing story. And when I talk about settler colonialism and Native people, I want you to always think about how have Native people been erased or they erase us, either through genocide or through ignoring us from conversations. How is that done? Because that's one of the things that we have to contend with all the time in our social spaces, is constantly making visible the invisible. But there are structures and policies like the doctrine of discovery and manifest destiny and origin narratives that are created to distort historical realities, free future settler generations from guilt and accountability, and rationalize and normalize continuous occupations and continuous rights to dispossess Native people of their lands and simultaneously erase Indigenous people from our land and social discourse. So just to give you a couple of examples of that, to give you an idea, doctrine of discovery was brought about initially introduced by Spain and was rationale for Columbus to be able to come here and especially on his second voyage to come in and in the pursuit of gold and slaves. And it basically decreed, it was a papal decree declared by the Pope, that any land inhabited by a people who are not Christians can be overthrown and the people can be enslaved and forced to adopt Christianity. Now, how does this impact Americans and society today? In 1823, the US federal law, Johnson versus McIntosh, actually cited the doctrine of discovery and became the rationale to allow dispossession of lands from Native people. And so these are the things that we're not always taught in school. And that's why we need to kind of highlight them to begin to see how these kinds of systems are actually embedded in our laws and our structures currently. If you want more information on that, I encourage you to go to the website nativephilanthropy.candid.org and timeline. It's there that you'll be able to see kind of a whole example of these events over time. Eve Tuck sums it up well. She says, everything within a settler colonial society strains to destroy or assimilate the Native in order to disappear them from the land. And this is how a society can have multiple simultaneous and conflicting messages about Indigenous people, such as all Indians are dead, located in faraway reservations, and that contemporary Indigenous people are less Indigenous than prior generations, and that all Americans are just a little bit Indian. That's all part of settler colonialism. Okay. Okay, now to give you another example of how the stories get rewritten to support the dominant narrative. When the Spaniards first came and then later anthropologists documented the story about the Spaniards coming, they basically said when the Choctaw, because we were one of the first people to encounter Spaniards when they first came, DeSoto to be exact, and his party, they said that, you know, we treated them as gods. And so when they start telling stories like that, the purpose of that is to say, we basically gave away our land, or we basically acquiesced to these people because that's what Native people do. That's the story that they would like us to believe. And their premise was that was because we had a belief in a white god or a white spirit that we held in such high esteem, so that when we saw the great white Spaniards coming, we immediately considered them to be of high status. That is not true. So here's how we decolonize when we start doing this work to undo these origin stories that are to uphold certain myths. Our term, and even the anthropologist talked about Oka Naholo as an example of that. And so here's Oka Naholo, what we really meant by that. it is true. We have a serpent that lives in the waters. And this is the name that we did give the Spaniards, what we gave to what we thought were what we called white people now. But this is the term that we gave them. And what Okanahalo it really is it's a serpent that lives in the water and it calls to you. It's a dangerous serpent. It'll call to you to come to the water, the whirlpools, so that you gaze into your reflection. And as you gaze into your reflection, you get caught up in looking at yourself and just thinking about how beautiful you are or how great you are. And as you're looking at yourself and you get caught up in looking at yourself, it comes out and it snatches you and it takes you into the depths of the water and it transforms you into one of them. That was our term for Okanahalo, for the Europeans that came here. That's a very insightful understanding of what that what they were encountering during that period. So that's an example of how the story gets rewritten and it's different than what really is. So now let's turn to historical traumatic events. How does settler colonialism relate to historical traumatic events? Well, historical trauma actually are the events that are created to uphold and perpetuate the systems of US settler colonialism. So these are the events, because I said settler colonialism is a structure, but it needs events to help support the structure. And historically, these traumatic events have been designed to uphold settler colonialism. So what do we mean by that? And this is, I want to acknowledge Dr. Tessa Evans Campbell and her great work in this area, as well as Dr. Maria Braveheart and many others. So to summarize, so that we're on the same page, historical trauma is conceptualized as an event or a set of events perpetrated on a group of people who share a specific identity, in this case for Native people. And they're designed to do three things. They're designed to A, eradicate a people through genocide. And if that's not successful, the other way is to eradicate life ways through what we call ethnocide. So the systematic destruction of language, identity, religion, culture. And the third element is to eradicate through thought ways, how people conceptualize and what I call epistemicide, their worldviews, knowledges, and epistemologies. Those three areas are directly attacked. The trauma is usually experienced as collective. It significantly impacts the community. It compounds over multiple generations. And again, many protective factors can protect people, so not everyone does poorly when they have these historically traumatic events, but nevertheless, they're very impactful on communities. Now, this is very different than having, for example, a great hurricane that comes through and destroys a community. That can persist for generations as well. But historical trauma is unique because these are human-made events that target a people for the eradication of culture, life ways, or thought ways. An example of one of these, and this is where you see the intersection of settler colonialism and historical trauma. American Indians and Alaska Natives were sold into slavery very early on. We're not taught that very much in our history books, so a lot of people don't know that. That's part of the erasure that we experience. But what we do know is that if we were to add up all the Native slaves that were taken in the New World from the time of Columbus to the end of the 19th century, the figure would run somewhere between 2.5 and 5 million Native slaves. My own tribe was enslaved into the triangle trade. We were decimated by slavery. And so we were sent to Haiti and other parts of the Caribbean during that period. And by the way, they targeted primarily women and children for the slave trade among the American colonists. Other examples of historically traumatic events, I'm not going to go too long into this, but there was a whole history of scalp hunting. Scalping and Indian hunting that was allowed by law, encouraged by law, even to the point the U.S. Army Medical Museum between the 1860s and the 1900s was calling for Indian remains to be able to have warehoused in the museums. And then there was a reservation era, which was also part of those historically traumatic events, which were Native people were being forced into these internment camps during that period. And then one that I think a lot of people are familiar with more, which is the boarding school, Native children being forcibly removed and placed into boarding schools. Hundreds of thousands of children removed from the 1890s onwards. And I'm raising this because this is still very close and near and dear to a lot of our our families, not far removed generation-wise from these experiences. This is Carlisle Indian School, and this is a young man that Tom Torino, a young Navajo man when he first arrived, and this is him 3 years later. These schools were designed to eradicate indigeneity in any form. It was coupled with the system of outlawing indigenous our religions and our right to practice our cultures and ceremonies, and children weren't allowed to speak the language. So there, it was a systematic attempt to move away from outright explicit genocide to ethnocide, which actually is still a part of genocide if you look at the UN definition of genocide. Another example here, more locally, these are Spokane Indian kids who were first put into Chamawa. And this is the same children a little bit afterwards. But despite these kinds of historically traumatic events, we are still here. We are still managing to thrive and survive. But they do have a toll on us. And here are three elements that I want us to think about the impact on. Historically traumatic events are designed to disrupt our ability to fulfill our original teachings. When General Sheridan said the best way to kill the Lakota was to kill the buffalo, that was a way of disrupting our ability to fulfill our original teachings, or the Lakota to be able to fulfill their original teachings, because it wasn't about just interrupting a food source, it was about interrupting their ability to conduct ceremony, to conduct their responsibilities to the buffalo nation, and so forth. So it was a much deeper attack. So it was historically traumatic events disrupt our original instructions. It disrupts our relational ways of being and our responsibilities to one another. When those children were put into boarding schools, it literally disrupted their family patterns and family relationships, but also relational ways of being to the world, to the environment, and to future generations as well, potentially. And the third element is it disrupts our how we talk and think about ourselves. So part of the work we do in decolonizing work is to transform our how we talk and think about ourselves. It's the narrative transformation elements that need to be put back into place or are already there, but continue to grow. So we've done some research on this to support this. A good example is we did look at historically traumatic events and can have an impact on substance use as well as post-traumatic stress disorder. So we basically found that the more controlling for one's own lifetime experience of trauma and all kinds of traumas, we kind of isolated that out to see if you can still see the impact of what happened to your grandparents and great-grandparents and great-great-grandparents, if that still had an impact on your well-being. And sure enough, we found that it did. That overall trauma across multiple generations was associated with elevated PTSD, and that actually direct attacks, if your community or if your ancestors experienced direct attacks, that was also associated with PTSD. And it was also associated with greater likelihood of alcohol-related problems in the last year, as well as cocaine and other stimulant use. And then finally, we also found that land-based historically traumatic events, if the land was even attacked over generations, that accounted for another 6% of variance in mental health outcomes. And so I think that's an important piece given the work that we see among activists and community members and protecting land, protecting water. And again, it gets back to that saying that I said at the beginning, I am the land is me. So let me talk a little bit about how do we then begin to think about transcending some of that. And I talked a little bit about how does original instructions first get disrupted. So let me share with you a little bit of a story about that. Original instructions are those ancient teachings about that provides the protocols and examples of healthful practices. And colonization has tried to disrupt our ability to have those stories. And we can find a lot of those teachings, even in our children's stories even, but we do still carry a number of teachings that help us. And when we think about developing interventions from a Native point of view, we can draw a lot from our original teachings to help guide those interventions. So a quick example is our story about Hashkanaya, who is the moon. And she was once upon a time shared the sky with Hashtali, the sun. And he and Hashkanaya were together, and they loved each other very much, and they had all of their beautiful star children, and they shared the beautiful day sky together. But Hashka and I noticed that once in a while, Hashtali lets off his sun flares every once in a while. And actually, I think we're due for some right now, actually, in terms of astronomy. But he lets off the sun flares every once in a while. And Hashka and I told him, listen, if any of those sun flares that you release ever hit me or my children, we are going to go to the other side of the world. I will have to take them and move to the other side of the world. And he said, oh, no, it'll be fine. It'll be fine. No, I can control my sun flares. And one day, sure enough, he got very upset about something, and he threw out a sun flare, and it hit Hashkanaya. Hashkanaya turned, and she gathered all of her star children, and she moved to the other side of the world. And that's why we have that darkness now. And she brought them there, and he pleaded for her to stay. And she said, no, I told you what our deal is. She said, but I love you. And so what I will do is once a month, I will share the night sky with you. Morning and night will come together, and we'll be together once a month, and that's it. And so that's the story that we have among the Choctaw, which is basically a domestic violence prevention story. We already have that embedded in our culture about how to respect and what is okay, what is not okay, and what happens if there's a violation of that. Obviously, we're a matrilineal, matriarchal society with respect to that. Another is the idea about relational restoration. So for us to heal from historical trauma, we have to build interventions that grow our original instructions. We have to build interventions that restore relational ways of being in this world. These are the ways of being annoying in the world through our original instructions. And it's important to reconnect to facilitate those connections and focus on intergenerational responsibilities. Relationality is reciprocal as well as spatial. It encompasses all ancestral responsibilities across generations. So let me give you an example about a quick example of the relational restoration focus. When people have been in a system of mental health system for a really long time, they're socialized into becoming what we call good clients. And quite often, part of that is developing a dependency on the system to define for them how to describe themselves. And that, from a Native point of view, that we don't think that that's super healthy. At least, you know, it's good to question that. And so a good example is Eduardo Duran gives this example, and I'm going to share it with you, of a client coming in for the first time. And the client walks in, and Ed will use a little bit of humor to begin to unsettle some of these norms of being a good client. And he'll ask the person, you know, tell me a little bit about yourself. Tell me about, you know, who are you? Why are you here? And this person will quite often say, well, you know, I'm here because I'm depressed. And then Ed will tease them a little bit and say, oh, okay, so tell me about that naming ceremony. You know, tell me about how your mother or your community named you depressed. And the client's going to look at him and say, what are you talking about? My name's John. And he's like, no, you told me your name's depressed. So let's talk about that really important ceremony you had, you know, that one where the great leaders came together, and those social workers and those doctors and those psychiatrists, and they gathered in a great sacred room. And they had usually a big table. And on that table, they had a sacred text called the DSM. And then they opened up that sacred text and they said, oh, this person shall be depressed. That's their name. So tell me how that ceremony that you received that name. Now that's a little bit of Indian humor to unsettle, but it also is communicating something really important in terms of decolonization and restoring a relational way of being. So is the idea that when you receive a name, you have a relationship to that name. And in that name, you have a relationship to community about expectations for how you would behave, how you see yourself, how you should conduct yourself, how others expect you to conduct yourself. So when you received a name from a Native point of view, you're receiving a way of being in this world. Are you aware of the power of that for you? He might also ask him, you know, tell me a little bit about when that depression visits you. Does it come at night? Does it wake you up? Now, again, the idea of depression visiting means you have a relationship to it. And if you have a relationship with depression, then you can put boundaries on it. You can stop, you know, say, hey, you don't get to come over and visit me anymore at 3 o'clock in the morning and knock my door and wake me up and say negative things to me. So humor can be used to address some of this, but the idea is that you have a relationship with this depression as opposed to you are your disease. Instead, from a native point of view, we're saying you are dis-ease. In other words, you're out of ease. You're out of balance. It's not that you are your depression, right? You have a relationship with this. So that's an example of recalibrating our relational responsibility more from a direct practice point of view. The next thing is the narrative transformation. I'm just going to give you a brief example of that. When I was first moved here into the Pacific Northwest, I was asked to consult and go meet with a community here help them with obesity prevention. Their youth had incredibly high rates of obesity and diabetes at very young age, type 2 diabetes. We're talking about 8, 9, and 10-year-olds. So there was obviously a real concern there for their long-term health and well-being. And they asked me to come and visit and talk with them about developing an intervention. So I went and did a little historical research, and I actually looked at archival photos of the community and discovered they were very lean in earlier times for the earlier photos that I could find. So it was interesting to me that they were dealing with really high rates of obesity and diabetes. So I met with these grandmas, and I walked into this room full of grandmas. And if you're familiar with Native people, if you walk into a room full of only grandmas, you know the very serious business is about to be conducted. And I, even though I'm Native, I'm an outsider to this particular community. So I knew I needed to really just listen and hear what they were thinking. And the first thing this lady said when this grandma stood up and she said, "Don't be sending any of these skinny white people in to tell us how to be or what to eat, because our bodies have always been big. We've always had big babies. That's who we are. So, you know, don't use those standards on us." That told me two important things. One is this community was willing to throw down for their children. I could work with that. We can work together on that, to really join on that, because that was really critical. They were really here to do something about this. So that was great. Told me another thing, that as an outsider, I needed to be careful about the points of view I bring into this conversation. And I needed to be respectful to really understand where they were coming from and what can we do to build up from their knowledges. It also told me that they had a story of being always big. When I just looked at this archival photo and it didn't match. So I thought, how is historical trauma part of this conversation? So remember I talked about historical trauma, that it's about love. And so I start with that when we talk about historical trauma at the community level. So I said, so tell me about the story when you first, about your original teachings about how you eat, how you gather food, how you hunt for food, how you fish for food. Tell me those stories. And we took the calendar off the wall and we started looking at the calendar, because traditional calendars in our indigenous languages tell us quite often what the protocols are for each of the month. And it's always tied to food and land. And so they had beautiful stories they shared. They said, when this one butterfly comes, that's when we pick this one berry. And they shared beautiful stories. And then I asked the next question. When I'm doing the historical drama work, we say, well, when did that get disrupted? You know, and they said, well, clearly when we got moved onto this reservation, we weren't allowed to hunt. We weren't allowed to gather food. We couldn't leave. They gave us a sack of flour. We thought it was poison. We wouldn't touch it for a while. We didn't know what to do. We starved. And it was a very, very dark time. And then I asked the third element, which is, what did your people do to survive? Because in historically traumatic events, people take action, and our ancestors take action to protect their children. So what did your ancestors do to make sure that you were here today? And they said, well, that's easy. You know, we made sure always our babies were well fed. The ones who were plump, or the ones, you know, who were well fed, they were the ones who were more likely to survive. And then the light bulb went off, the aha moment happened, because they realized that the story that they're saying is cultural was in fact, you know, the cultural that we're always big was in fact a historical trauma response, a survival response to be protective. And so that gave us a chance to say, well, is that now working for this generation? Because obesity is just the flip side of the same coin as starvation. Either way, you're malnourished. And so then they led, and they had a beautiful talk about what the next steps were. So that's an example of how you start to transition the narrative and think about it differently. Okay, so Historical trauma, the final closing thoughts before I share a little bit about Yapoli. We are not to be defined by the historical trauma, but really by our original instructions and our teachings. Colonizers and colonization, settler colonialism would love for us to be victims and to be saved. And colonial dependency, the idea that the nation state requires us to be dependent on it, like being a good client in the sense that I gave earlier, can creep into helping systems and the medicalization of historical trauma. And that's not what we want you want to do. But there is the real question, what do we do to transcend historical trauma? What are the things that we need to do to move forward? And I just want to share with you, so this is the wind part of this, the presentation, the ceremony. We need to have a paradigm shift. And so let's talk a little bit about the one that helped me make the shift. I was listening to a Hawaiian elder share a story, and this is the story about crabs in the bucket. And for those of you who are familiar with the crabs in the bucket syndrome, we use that a lot to talk about in common language. It's a phrase to describe lateral violence, community violence and oppression that we do within group to each other. So when someone starts to climb out of a situation, we pull them back down. So it's used to describe that kind of behavior because fishermen can put crabs in a bucket and crabs will do that. That's what crabs behave like when they're put in a bucket. And so this elder said, you know, we accept that this is crab behavior. You know, that by using this expression, we say crabs in the bucket means that we're going to be violent towards each other. And he said, but do crabs live in a bucket? And I was like, oh my God, no, crabs don't live in a bucket. And it made me realize, you know, if I was a crab in the bucket, a social worker crab, I'd all be in there and I'd be working really hard to do some good crab organizing. We would probably, I'd say, let's lift each other up and we can climb out of this bucket together. We could work really hard on this bucket. But this elder reminded us of something very simple. This is not crab behavior. This is bucket behavior. Crabs do not live naturally in a bucket. Where do crabs naturally live? In the ocean, in the water. And what is crab healthful behavior when they are in their health environment, their behavior is to lift each other up on rocks. That's the natural healthful crab behavior. And that made me realize, you know, well, first of all, let's just say there may be a couple of crabs that are bad that might knock each other off, bad behavior. But general crab behavior is very positive when they're in their healthful environment. And that made me realize, what are we doing sometimes when we accept the bucket of historical trauma or even settler colonialism to define how we respond and create interventions, that we need to think outside of the bucket, that we actually need to bust down the bucket to begin to develop interventions that are based on our creating environments that can promote our healthy behaviors to continue to grow and emerge. And so that led me to think a little bit more about this quote, we cannot solve our problems with the same thinking they used when they created them. And we can thank Albert Einstein for that quote. And this is the reason why decolonization really matters. It's not about having it remain a metaphor, but really doing a decolonizing and an indigenizing approach to health promotion efforts to create opportunities for these helpful, to change environments. So it's not enough to change our behaviors and working on helping people change their behaviors, but actually change the environments in which behaviors happen, that both of these things need to happen. So this doesn't mean that we can just simply take Western knowledge and native practices and just mix them all up and assume we're gonna have equal footing here. It's not about just mixing it up, but stirring it up. It's not about tagging a feather and putting an Indian feather on or slap a medicine wheel onto an intervention. It really is about a synthesis of two ways of knowing and taking the best of both to grow a response that's going to be most helpful and not confined by the bucket or the box in which we're already finding ourselves. So that takes a lot of work to decolonize and free our minds, including even us as Indigenous people. And so that turns to my last part of my talk, which is talking a little bit about how does this translate into the work that we've done with Choctaw Nation and a project called Yapoli. And this is about a study about following the path of our ancestors to just literally to transcend historical trauma and create health promotion interventions. So I'm going to share briefly with you how we created a health promotion intervention by and for Choctaws derived directly from our culture, as opposed to borrowing from an existing intervention that's out there and then translating it to us. Instead, we said, we need to create our own. And I'll tell you a little bit about how that happened. I want to acknowledge our leadership team, Dr. Michelle John Jennings, who's a co-principal investigator on this project with myself and doctors, and Sandy Stroud, who is our project director in Oklahoma. So this is a partnership between University of Washington, University of Saskatchewan, and Choctaw Nation of Oklahoma. It's a unique project. It's all Choctaw-led. And it's very unusual to get Choctaw researchers as well as Choctaw community members and providers all working together. And also Christy Brooks, I want to acknowledge out at Choctaw Nation, head of behavioral health there. Our tribe, just to give you a quick background, just so you know, we originally originated in this area, and now we've settled into, we're forcibly removed. And that's, we're going to talk a little bit about that, called the Trail of Tears, to southeastern Oklahoma. And the red territory there was Choctaw, and now we're, that's our territory in southeastern Oklahoma. By the way, our territory, our reservation, now I could say it's now, it's officially a reservation, is bigger than the state of Massachusetts. A lot of people aren't aware of that. We still go by traditional names in our territory for the towns and the areas and places where we settle. So you'll see places like Nashoba, Boktuklo. These are all Choctaw names. So a number of years ago in 2011, Choctaw Nation came and talked with us, and the director noted that one out of three Choctaw children were projected to have type 2 diabetes by 2050. And he said 70% of our people are currently obese. And that he was really worried that he wanted to stop this moving train as quickly as possible, because basically we're in a situation where grandchildren grandparents were going to outlive their grandchildren. That's how bad it was going. And I had a chance to talk with them, and I toured a bunch of different amazing facilities that we have for health facilities. And I have to acknowledge our tribe is doing amazing work, doing top of the line behavioral research, doing everything from the individual level. We have the best, we're better than Gold's Gym. We have fitness gyms and facilities. We have walking paths. We've changed menus. We had a Go Lean campaign. We've done amazing work on the structural level, all the way down to the behavioral level, stomach surgeries and intensive food programs to help people with obesity prevention. All of that's been done in our tribe based on primarily Western frameworks that we've adapted to be Choctaw. It has had a dent, but it's not moving at the speed and the pace that it needs to outpace the impact and the level of obesity and diabetes that we're dealing with right now. So they asked us to think about doing something that was more culturally specific, that could be responsive and be different than what we've been doing before. And so I had a chance to partner with Sharon Fleming, the chief sister, on this project initially. And I walked away as the researcher saying, "Well, wow, we're doing, our tribe's doing everything right. They're doing everything by the Western health equity cookbook, but it's not making enough of a dent. So what do we need to do differently?" And I actually went away and I actually prayed about it. It was really, I had to go into a different place to think about this. And I have to tell you, the first thing that really came to my mind that was so simple and it came very quickly was, our ancestors did not re-walk that trail of tears for us to be dying like we're currently dying. They knocked that trail of tears with that vision of health that we are currently in right now. They had a different vision of living and love and life that we have an obligation to get reconnected to, and that we're responsible for and stewarding for our next several generations. So whatever intervention we need to develop needs to keep that in mind, that we need to reconnect to that love and life and vision that they had. And so we met and we decided after several meetings, and then we brought Dr. Michelle Johnson Jennings involved and Carrie Harrod through the behavioral health team involved. And what we decided and we proposed to the was that we needed to create our own pilot work to develop our own Choctaw-specific health promotion model. And that the way to develop our worldview and our own curriculum and a way to think about how to do this was through rewalking the Trail of Tears. And it wasn't about trying to get reconnected to the drama of the Trail of Tears, but to actually by walking literally on the land. So this place-based generative activity would then lead to developing a curriculum and an intervention and insights about how we needed to approach this. And this is an example of how we had to decolonize right away, because the elders were saying, "Whoa, great, you can take youth with you and you can do substance abuse prevention curriculum and you can do," and we said, no, that's the point. We wanna actually wake up each morning and we're gonna do our prayers and we're gonna offer our thoughts to be open as we walk 8 to 10 miles each day, the same amount of steps our ancestors took on these trails. As we walk, we're gonna ask the question, not about substance abuse prevention, but you know, what are our original teachings around substances and medicines? And how do we relate to them properly? And if we get out of relationship with them or we're unhealthy in our relationship to them, what are the consequences and how can we take corrective action? Instead of suicide prevention, we were asking, what are our values for living and life? And if we get out of balance, how do we take corrective action? So those are the kinds of ways we wanted to approach this. So we walked over 10 days. The elders said we had to go do it in June. I don't know if any of you are familiar, but walking through Arkansas in June is incredibly hot. We walked well over 255 miles over 9 days, almost 10, starting at one of the major deportation sites where Choctaws had gathered. And then we walked 8 to 10 miles per day. And the goal was to actually map the trails, to develop our health promotion model out of this experience, to look at archival research about what our ancestors were thinking during that period so that we can get a clear vision idea of what we're committing to for future generations. And then also we were very cognizant of the fact that we were doing land-based cultural intervention, that we felt that the intervention we were going to design and develop was going to be land-based and come from being on the trail. And we already know from research that, you know, there's scientific benefits of land-based cultural interventions. It increases cognitive dissonance, it opens one up to learning, which we discovered from our pilot work. It literally changes the chemicals in your brain. You get back in touch with your original teachings, removes you from daily stressors to kind of focusing on your embodiment in place in that moment. And you have an opportunity to remember ancestral ways of healing in this process. So we started out at Choctaw Nation. We started with a very simple question, which is, what is the Choctaw road to health? That's me putting on my moccasins to walk part of the trail. So literally leaving some of the Western science behind to go into an indigenous space. We approached this through ceremony. So we actually prepared ourselves ceremonially for this as well. So although we're doing community-based participatory research, because we had the community that joined us in helping to design this and create this experience. We kind of jokingly, but not, called a ceremonially based participatory research, because ceremony was part of that to enter into this process. I'll talk a little bit more about that. I went to the Smithsonian and literally looked at archival maps and military maps, and we did GIS mapping. We worked with what naturally emerged was women came forward saying, we want to actually do this work. And we were a little worried about that. We talked to elders in the tribe and they said, well, actually it makes sense that women are coming forward to do this work, to go on this trail, to help develop this health promotion model through their experience, because women historically, we were the ones who restored the balance when a big traumatic event came. So we were responsible for that in terms of the tribe and the people. So for the elders, they said, this makes total sense that women before. Everything was allowed to be part of the research. Dreams, archival research, oral history. We talked with a lot of people about oral history, about the trail and their families. We incorporated Choctaw principles in our conduct of research. We talked to elders and brought in the language to help us understand how to listen, how to be in relation to the land and place and the teachings. We did ceremony, like I said, to prepare our bodies and our minds to be able to receive instructions. Now, unlike Western models, you know, Native teachings around receiving knowledge is that knowledge isn't something out there to be grabbed and taken. Rather, knowledge is something that you approach and you have a relationship with, and it may or may not, you may or may not get it. You can go out and, you know, go out and try to do a fast and seek a vision, but you may not get one. So it's how you approach it that really, really matters. And so we prepared ourselves properly in that way. The idea was that we're going to, the trail will bring up some things that will help us to work through and reflect on. And that those three elements I talked about earlier, we're asking about what are original instructions? What are the relational restoration activities that we need to put in place? And how do we transform how we talk and think about ourselves, the narrative transformation? We actually ended up conducting two pilot studies, which I won't have time to get into all of the details of it. But that included, we did GIS blogging of the military map so people could follow us as we went on the trail. We created a preliminary curriculum that we can begin to test and see how it feels on the trail. And we started with 13 Choctaw walkers, 5 Native allies, and 3 non-Natives who came with us on the journey. And I just, here's a couple of the shots of walking the Trail of Tears that we did. And we start off in our lands, and here's some of the families we had that went with us. And her son Kai, and Carrie and her son Caleb, and Michelle and her daughter Alaya. I'm raising this as a picture here because we were allowed to bring parent-child pairs, which actually makes sense because parents and children were on the trails together, but we were not allowed to bring anyone under the age of 13 or 12 because of safety issues on the trail, because there's rattlesnakes and water moccasins and things like that. This is walking the Trail of Tears. Some of the shots, we sang songs on the trail. Laughter is medicine, we discovered on the trail. And so we made several trail observations coming off of the first trip. One is the importance of cultural connectedness, that actually being on the trail is very powerful because being in place and land and pushing yourself through this created some disequilibrium that was gave people an opportunity to reflect on and rebuild on. So reconnecting to the body and out of the head into the body. Our young person said on the trip, we did do qualitative research. We did interviews before the trail. We did interviews after the trail about people's experiences. We even did focus groups on the trail, which I would never recommend again. But we did ask on the focus group, we asked the people to reflect on what they were discovering about what lessons they're learning for themselves that we can begin to think about creating this curriculum. And this young woman on the trip summed it up beautifully. She said, I get it. So if I am a healthy teenager right now and I take care of my health right now, then that's all I have to do is be a happy, healthy teenager. And then I am going to that everyone's going to benefit from that. The next generation is going to benefit from that. The current community is going to benefit from that. Even the ancestors who I still carry the issues in my body from my ancestors, they're benefiting from that. And we're like, okay, we're done. She got it. And so that was amazing to see that kind of talk come out of it. It was what we thought, that narrative, that restoring the trauma, restoring and transforming that trauma into a different way of understanding how to take care of one's own health. So these are just some of the quotes. We do talk about it. We know people talk about ancestors like they're still present today, which I'm not surprised, but that medicine as laughter is important. But when you continue to center the trauma, then you continue to center the colonizing process. And so we realized we needed to really center the laughter and the healing and other aspects that are really critical. We started thinking, well, what are some of the mechanisms to motivate people to change? And we actually did borrow from the Western framework to help help us begin to think about that as well, which is called the IMB model. So the idea is that if you get information that is culturally from our community, that cultural knowledge, that becomes the motivation to have radical change. And then I also, because I'm running out of time, which is why I share, this is the model that came out of that work. We did two pilot studies and we came back and we met with each other as well as other Choctaw colleagues. And out of this, a lot of reflection, we realized that our ancient clan structures had teachings that they can teach us about that we can translate into a behavioral health promotion model. And that's actually what we ended up doing. So each of the clan systems basically guide us in terms of our own journey to improving our health and wellness, that it starts with us as individuals. And then we, as they work through this curriculum, they begin to learn more about community organizing skills and opportunities to create community events for health prevention events. So starting from the self and then outward to the larger community, and the clans guide us through the protocols and ways of things that we need to address during that. So we focused then, we said, even though substance use and obesity were the big areas that our tribe was worried about, we didn't want to create an intervention that says, oh, by the way, this is just about substance use and obesity. We felt that it's really important and part of our reframing and decolonizing that we said, well, actually, we're developing an intervention that's going to be about building community health leaders, guided by this kind of clan system model that we've created. And so that's what we did. And we were funded by the National Institute of Drug Abuse. And now we are working with 150 Choctaw women, 30 women per district, where they go through a 12-week intervention, working through the clan system model and curriculum that we developed. And they start with themselves, working through what behaviors and things that they want to continue to grow and change for their children and grandchildren and great-grandchildren. But also then giving them, working with them to develop and grow further. A lot of them are already leaders, but grow further in their leadership skills to do community interventions and organizing. And so for example, if we had someone who passed away in a community from an overdose, for example, ideally, because they've gone through all of this model, the women who are identified with the White Crane group, because the women eventually place themselves in these different clans, the women who identify with White Cranes would call all the other White Crane women to come and join her in doing a community prevention event, for example, to prevent another overdose or prevent suicide prevention. The idea was that we wanted to create an intervention that was sustainable, that was based on our cultural values and our commitment to ongoing service as Indigenous people to our community, that's based on our teachings, and it doesn't cost a lot of money to do. And so it's really about building back and building up our cultural norms that we already have in place. So people are initiated into these societies, and then they continue to do work. At the end of the 12 weeks, we take them on a vow making ceremony by rewalking the Trail of Tears to step into becoming these health leaders. So they go for 8 days and live on the Trail of Tears like we did. And then they're received with a community feast and gathering by their community as these health leaders and people that they can go to. And then we also provide them with a little pot of money to be able to do a sustainable community intervention, health intervention at the local level. There's still interventions going 4 years later, for example, Walking Warriors, a group of women who walk and continue to support each other. It's actually hit the internet, and so now they do it online, and it's pretty amazing. The three guiding questions through this work is, what kind of ancestor did my ancestors envision me to be? What kind of ancestor do I want to be? And what kind of ancestor do I want our future generations to be? So I'm going to end there to let you know that that's the work that we've been doing. And I realize I've gone over my time, so I think it's time I stop now. But I just want to say, Yokoke, thank you for having me and allowing me to share a little bit of the work that we've been doing.
Thank you so much. You know, just before we end, I just want to say that there are so many messages on the YouTube site with comments of gratitude and just thanking you so much for the presentation. Ariana Cantu, who we all know, or many of us know, said that she really needed that origin story today. And sends her gratitude for sharing your wisdom as always. So we want to just thank everybody for joining us today. And
thank you.
Thanks always to Brooks, who is our behind the scenes IT person, and Tessa Evans Campbell for representing the Dean's office. And last but not least, of course, to our speaker tonight, Dr. Karina Walters. Thank you so much, everyone, for joining us.
Thank you.